The absolutely indispensable element of dynamic programming is what we'll call an optimal similar substructure. By this, I mean that we have some hard problem that we want to solve, and we think to ourselves, oh, if I only had the answer to these two similar smaller subproblems, this would be easy. And because the subproblems are similar to the original, we can keep playing this game, letting the problems get smaller and smaller until we've reached a trivial case. Well, at first, this feels like an ideal case for recursion. Since the subproblems are similar, perhaps we can use the same code and just change the parameters. Starting from this hard problem, we could recurse back to this one, and then to this one, and so forth, using this whole subgraph here to solve this subproblem. But when we recurse through this branch, we would come to this node again and do all this recomputation again, which would be terribly wasteful. This is sometimes called one of the perils of recursion, and it's often illustrated to beginning programmers with the example of computing the Fibonacci sequence. Each number in the Fibonacci sequence is the sum of the previous two numbers, and the first two numbers are 1 to get us started. This hard problem of computing the nth number in the sequence depends on solving the slightly easier problems of computing the n minus 1th and the n minus 2th elements in the sequence. Figuring out n minus 1 depends on n minus 2 as well as n minus 3. N minus 2 depends on knowing the answer to n minus 3 and n minus 4, and so forth. Thinking about how the recursion will operate here, notice that we need to compute f sub n minus 2 once for f sub n, and once also for s sub n minus 1. So there's going to be some repeated computation here, and it's going to get worse and worse the further to the left we go. How bad does it get? Well, the top-level problem of computing the nth number will only be called once, and he will call the f minus 1 subproblem once as well. Computing f sub n minus 2 needs to happen once for each time that the two computations that depend on it are called, once for n minus 1 and once for n. Similarly, n minus 3 needs to be called once for every time that the subproblems that depend on it are called, twice for f sub n minus 2 and once for f sub n minus 1, for a total of 3. F sub n minus 4th gets computed once for each time that f sub n minus 3 is called and once for each time that f sub n minus 2 is called, for a total of 5. Notice that each number here is the sum of the two numbers to the right. So this actually is the Fibonacci sequence. And the number of times that the n minus kth number is computed will be equal to the kth Fibonacci number, which is roughly the golden ratio raised to the kth power. So yikes, this recursive strategy is exponential. Of course, computing the Fibonacci numbers doesn't need to be exponential. We could just start on the left here, initializing the first two numbers to 1 and 1, and then compute the next one as the sum of the previous two with a simple for loop. There are two ways to cope with this problem of repeated computation. One is to memoize the answers to the subproblems. After we solve it the first time, we write ourselves a memo with the answer, and before we actually do the work of solving a subproblem, we always check our wall of memos to see if we have the answer already. So, for instance, for this subproblem here, I would have memoized it, written myself a memo to remember that I've already done it, and so when I come this path here, I wouldn't redo all this computation, I just look up the answer. Alternatively, we can solve the subproblems in the right order, so that any time we want to solve one of the problems, we are sure that we have the answer to its subproblems already. This can always be done because the dependency relationships among the subproblems must form a directed acyclic graph. If there were a cycle, then we would have a circular dependence and the recursion wouldn't work either. So we just find an appropriate ordering of the subproblems so that all the edges go left to right, and then we solve the subproblems in left to right order. This is the approach we'll take for this lesson. It tends to expose more the underlying nature of the problem and create faster implementations than using recursion and memoizing.